Hello friends, just let me start today's activity some special way. Can you see something inside the glass? And what is that? Candle is burning inside the glass. Now what I am doing here, if you see carefully, there is a glass and candle is inside, flame is inside. Now what I am doing here, I want to show you my candle here burning inside the water. So let me add some water over here. Now my candle is flame, totally submerged in the water, and it is not distinguishing. Switch on the light, please. The candle, basically I have poured the water on the image where the glass where I kept. Okay, so this is a very very interesting experiment. You can see through this light there is a basically So what I am doing now, I am keeping the cap over here and placing the coin. Now let me show you the water over here, and I am not changing the position of my bowl and the coin. So let me pour the water on the bowl, and you can see to me. So what I am doing now, I am pouring the water over here and I'm not changing the position of the my bowl and the coin. So let me pour the water on the bowl, and you can see that disappearing coin is appeared due to the addition of the water. And this is a very very simple example. So basically, I have not changed the position of the coin, not the position of the bowl, anything, but just I have added the water. Actually, what happened with this? Now it is visible.
It's get bent. That bending of the light from going from one medium to the other medium, and that is called as a refraction. Now I would like to explain this demonstration with help of the diagram. You mind, please? Now let me repeat this experiment once, so you'll get the idea. Now here again, let me repeat this experiment. So basically, see, there is a bowl.
Help of the diagram. You mind, please? Okay. Now let me repeat.
And the coin. Now you have to go a little bit.
So you'll get the idea. Now here.
Of the bowl without changing anything, just I am adding the water over there. So let me add the water
behind such a distance, the coin should be disappear to you. Now it is a disappearing to me, but and also for the camera. Now what I am doing now without changing,
and why? So this is a very very interesting phenomena, refraction of the light. And last time I mentioned you, when light goes from rarer medium to denser medium, air to water, it's bend. That bending of the light is called as a refraction. So I would like to explain what is happening over here with help of the diagram. Iman, can you show this diagram? Please look at this diagram.
From rarer medium to denser medium.
Point over here. So this is my position of the
bend. That bending of the light is called as a refraction. So I would like to explain what is happening over here with help of the diagram. Iman, can you show this diagram?
Please look at this diagram. See the original thing. I have kept the coin over here. So this is my position of the coin towards our eye. And that's why if you extend this ray at the back, this coin appears somewhere over here.
So I mention you. So straight line, and what happened?
Bending of the light is called as a refraction. So this is a very nice experiment to explain the refraction, and anybody can do this experiment in the home. You need basically one just katora, any vessel, bowl, but shallow. Don't take very deeper. Don't take the glass. Okay. So it's very simple experiment, and you in your daily life you always see what you see in your daily life, like a swimming tank. Sometimes it is filled with water, it appears shallow. Any water tank, it appears shallow than this original depth, because due to the refraction, it's happened because bending of the light, as I mentioned, you feel light goes from denser to the rarer medium. Okay. Now let me take another experiment. Dinesh, give me another experiment, please. So this is my another experiment now. I need this one. Again, I need the oil and the. Yes, thank you very much. So look here. Basically, I am showing you one more very very interesting experiment.
Again, with the principle of the refraction. So basically, what is there?
You see that there is a clear glass over here. Clear glass slab. Suppose you don't have the glass slab.
You can use any glass. Any glass, very very transparent. That is the key thing. Now if I place this glass block in the my this vessel, and this is also transparent glass, so basically you can easily distinguish there is a glass and this is a air around the glass or inside the glass. Okay. And you can see the two objects over here. Now what I am doing, I am adding here the oil. Basically I am adding this vessel. and this is also transparent glass. So basically you can easily distinguish there is a glass and this is a air around the glass or inside the glass. Okay, and you can see the two objects over here. Now what I am doing, I am आप देख रहे हैं, और अभी मैं क्या करूंगा, इसमें थोड़ा सा पहले ऑयल डालता हूं और यू कैन से लेट मी पोर हाफ ऑफ द ऑयल ओवर हियर करूंगा. आपको क्या ऑब्जर्व करना है, अभी आपको ये ग्लास स्लैब बहुत अच्छी सी दिखाई रही. यू आर लुकिंग दिस ग्लास स्लैब ना, आप देख रहे हैं, और अभी बट आउटसाइड द ऑयल यू सी द ग्लास स्लैब. नाउ इफ आई फिल दिस ग्लास विद द ऑयल, अभी आपको क्या लग रहा है, व्हाट यू आर लुकिंग नाउ इनसाइड द ऑयल, इनसाइड द ऑयल दिस ग्लास इज नॉट विजिबल. लर्न इन आवर टेक्स्ट बुक समथिंग लाइक सम द कंसेप्ट इज रिफ्रैक्टिव इंडेक्स, एंड व्हाट इज दैट, व्हेन लाइट गोज फ्रॉम रियरर टू डेंसर मीडियम हाउ मच लाइट गेट बेंड, दैट बेंडिंग ऑफ लाइट इज अ रिफ्रैक्ट, दैट ऑल्सो डिपेंड अपॉन द रिफ्रैक्टिव इंडेक्स ऑफ द material, how much bending, refractive index. Here if you see the refractive index of the oil and the refractive index of the glass slab, basically material of, so refractive index of the both material are the same and close to same, not exactly but close to same, and that's why my glass slab is invisible in the oil, because when light goes through this oil and also through the glass doesn't change the speed, so the refractive index is same, that's why my glass is here invisible, my glass is invisible. Now I would like to request Neha or Ankesh, you just keep this aside and give me the third experiment. Okay, so basically if you see carefully what I am doing here now, just and give me the glass, I need the glass again, yes, and that water also, give me the water and glass. What kind of the material I am using here, this is basically foam rubber. Suppose you don't have the foam rubber, you can use the car seat, whatever you have in your house you can use that. Here also what I did now, so let me show you the direction of the arrow. What I did, we stick the arrow over here, okay, this arrow, see the direction of the arrow this way. You can use the car seat, whatever you have in your house, put first empty glass in front of the arrow. So I have just kept the direction of the arrow. What I did, we stick the arrow over here, okay, this arrow, see the direction of the arrow this way, and what I am doing now here, so let me put first empty glass in front. I am just adding the water, and you have to just carefully see the what happened with the direction of the arrow. Can you see now? Water over here. I am just adding the water, and you have to just carefully see the what happened with the direction of the arrow. Can you see now? It is reverse. This very very interesting phenomena, again I am showing with help of the diagram, but I am telling you, you need cylindrical transparent glass and of course any object. Suppose instead of this one arrow, if I place anything, suppose I am showing you now this number, what is this number for you, zero, you need cylindrical transparent glass and of course any object. Suppose instead of this one arrow, what I am doing here, see this number, and I am keeping over here this number, what is this number for you, 008, okay. Suppose if I look this way, it looks 800 for me. Now what I am doing, 008 basically, yes, clear. Now exactly ulta, Ankesh, suppose we just solve small mathematical problem over here, look here now, what is that, 8008 basically, yes, clear, very good. Now similarly, suppose we just solve small mathematical problem over here, if I place other object, and what is that? Can you read over here? Write the number, and if I place, you will look exactly opposite of that what I showed in the earlier. Okay. Now, if I place other object, and what is that? Can you read over here? Now, yes, it's a now. But if I place this name, I have to adjust the distance between glass and your object. And suppose if you write something like this, MOM, mom, then of course see the lab. Just let me change the position. Okay, good. So basically, you have to adjust the distance between glass and your object. And sir, MOM, mom, again mom, because see the two letters, design of the two letters. Okay, so this is a very, very interesting activity, basically on the refraction. And if I explain, you'll get the idea. You just focus on this diagram to explain. Suppose this is your glass of the water. I'm showing you the glass of the water over here. So this is a very, very interesting activity, basically on the refraction. And if I explain, you'll get the idea. You just focus on this diagram to explain. Suppose this is your glass of the water. I'm showing you the glass of the water over here. And suppose this is your object, which is very, very close. Last time I showed you the focal length and the radius of the curvature. So basically, I have kept very close this object in the camera. Normally use the lenses. In the convex lens, you see the image. And that is also depend upon what is the size of the image and the inverse image or the real image. That is depend upon the where you keep that object. Okay. So this is the diagram for this reversing the arrow. Now keep this thing over there. Now I would like to add now here. And one challenge for you, give me this bottle. Instead of the glass, you have to do this experiment in home. This is kind of the homework for you. Suppose you don't have this cylindrical glass, try with the flat bottle. And see whether can you reverse the direction of the arrow. And if it's not working, then you have to use this one. So basically, you have to see the difference between the flat object and the object like the cylindrical object with help of the kind of the glass. Okay, now give me the third one. Yes. So basically, I'm showing you very, very interesting experiment here based on the light and the reflection image formation here. Last time I showed you there are two kinds of the mirror. It's called as a very interesting experiment here based on the light. I'm using the convex mirror. Okay, there are two mirrors. This type of the convex mirror, normal of the mirror, is called as a spyware. To see the background, rear view, they always use the convex mirrors in the for the vehicle. So, if I place, suppose, this candle in front of the mirror, see the background, rear view, they always use the convex mirrors. Looking now? I'm showing you here the size candle in front of the mirror, and that is my convex mirror. And let me lead the candle. So what you are looking now is always small, very small. So basically here, if you see carefully from the camera and the size of the image, suppose if you use the convex mirror with help of the convex mirror, I'm talking about the mirror now. So, you got the idea, you always get the smaller image in the convex mirror. Now, let me replace this mirror I am using now. So, let me take this candle. So, I adjust the height of the candle basically. And so, what I am doing here now, this is my candle and I am putting here my concave mirror. So this is a different kind of the mirror. Concave surface is concave over here. Earlier was the convex. And in the earlier image, that convex mirror image you saw, that is a small but virtual. We can't take that image on the screen. And here I am taking this image on the screen. See the position now. I am keeping the candle over here. and my screen is somewhere here. So basically I have to align now. So let me align. Okay, now I need a switch of the light, please. I am keeping the candle over here and my screen is somewhere here. So basically I have to align now. So let me align. Okay, now I need a switch of the light, please. And I need to adjust little bit. Okay, good. Very good now. Can you see the image? So basically, if you see the flame and if you see the image of the flame, a real image with help of the concave mirror. Because you see the image is inverted basically. So I'm showing you here, and this is my real image. I'm showing you the real image with help of the concave mirror. And I also change the position of the screen and the object, and see the smaller now. I am showing you very, very small. Look here, small. Now my screen is very, very close. Now it is a larger image of the same candle. Okay, means you are here, you get the exactly inverted image and the size of the image. Basically, switch on the light, please. Size of the image mainly. Here is your object. Okay, and last time I mentioned you, of course, the mirror having the, of course, focus, the radius of the curvature. If you keep object very, very behind from the radius of the curvature, that is also called as a center of that sphere, spherical mirror, then you get smaller image on the screen. But if you shift your object very closer to the mirror, then that time the image start enlarging and enlarging, and ultimately you get the bigger image. So basically, image depend upon the where is your object. Okay, so basically you saw the image with help of the concave mirror, and this is the real image. Again, I am showing you the real one, and in earlier was the virtual. Okay, so please take this one. Yes. Now, this is all about the reflection of the light with help of the mirrors. Now, I am showing you the refraction. Friend, light passes. This is all about the reflection of the light. That is actually refraction. So, for that, what we did, just we made the stand with help of the foam rubber seat, or you can use a car seat. And here, see the, if you see carefully, this lens is thicker at the center. It's very thick at the center and thin at the edge. Okay. So basically, this is a convex lens. And what I am doing now, see the arrangement now. I am keeping, if you see carefully, this lens is thicker at the center. It's very thick at the center and thin at the edge. Okay. So basically, this is a convex lens. And what I am doing now, see the arrangement now. I am keeping my candle over here. Okay. So basically, if you see carefully, so let me adjust the first and then I will show the image. Okay, switch off the light, please. Now, okay. Basically, if you see carefully, so let me adjust the first and then I will show the image. Okay, switch off the light, please. Now, switch off. Very actually clear image. large and enlarge depend upon the place of the object. Okay. The concave lens, in the concave lens, if you see any object, suppose I am looking this object, this name basically, it's very small for me. And if you see in the camera, size of the image, Dinesh or Ankesh, can you see the smaller image in the, on the, so basically if you have the concave lens, and as I mentioned you, concave lens is thicker at the edge and thinner at the middle. So basically here, you see the very small image. In the concave lens, you get the smaller image. But I can't take this image on my screen. So this is my virtual image basically. I'm showing you the virtual. I can't take this on the screen. Now in all the images, what you look here, you saw I'm using either mirrors, concave lenses, convex lenses. But here I'm showing you the image without any lens or mirror. So what we did here, if you see carefully, this is my box. This is my box. And we fix here the kind of the translucent paper, butter paper. Suppose you don't have the butter paper, what you can do, you can take any photocopy paper and put some oil on that. Thoda sa oil laga do kaun se bhi paper pe, bas tumhara translucent paper ho jayega. Aur ek side mein kya karna hai, you have to make the smaller hole. ये बॉक्स को मेरा स्मॉल होल है बेसिकली यहां देयर इज अ स्मॉल होल सो आई एम कीपिंग दिस बॉक्स ओवर हियर एंड आई एम पुटिंग द कैंडल बट राइट नाउ यू कांट सी दैट्स व्हाई आई एम रिवर्सिंग इट ओके सो बेसिकली माय पोजीशन ऑफ द कैंडल इज एग्जैक्टली इन फ्रंट ऑफ द होल आई एम कीपिंग द कैंडल इन फ्रंट ऑफ द होल बट अपोजिट साइड ऑफ यू ओके एंड नेहा आई नीड अ डार्क इन दिस एक्सपेरिमेंट बट लेट मी स्विच ऑन द कैंडल फर्स्ट Okay, so basically, but you always see in the pinhole camera, you'll get very faint image, not like the mirror image or with help of the lenses. So here you'll always get very faint image. So let me show you. Can I see from here? Yes, switch off the light, please. And yes, see, if you switch off the light, but look here, can you see here? Exactly this, you see the image over here and you also see this ulta image. Inverted image. You see the image. So basically, this image is very faint. But you can take the image without using any mirror or lens, just with help of the pinhole camera. And here I have used one hole. That's why you see the only one image. Now, but some modification is there. Nani has switched on the light. So let me explain in. To you first and then I will see here just one hole there there is a one hole now what I am doing here now I am using the other box but let me change the height of the candle so this is my another candle okay so basically here I am using the other candle and instead of the one hole look here how many holes are there you see the total three eight and at the middle ninth eight and at the middle ninth hole so I have made the multiple holes over here instead of the single hole but very small hole if you see this very small hole so if I place now this candle exactly over here but let me make it ulta okay and again I am requesting Neha please switch off the lights so to see the multiple image okay There are, and I have to shift this position of the candle such a way that it should be exactly in front of the hole. Okay. Yes, clear now. Can you see now? There are multiple candles because I have made multiple holes on that box. One hole, one image. More hole, more image. And all the image are again the inverted position. So basically you can take very nice images by using the multiple holes. Sorry for I have initially there is a little bit disturbance due to some technical problem, sorry for that, but don't worry, we'll repeat that experiment in case if there is some problem. Okay, now let me move this thing over here. You saw now images with help of the lenses, mirrors, and without any mirror or lenses, that is a pinhole. Okay, now the next I would like to show you this is a multiple, how to take the multiple image. I would like to request Dinesh, can you show the multiple, how to take the multiple? If you visit in any kind of the mall, you see the multiple image of yourself. So how to make the multiple images with help of the two mirror? I would like to request Dinesh, please come here and show some images, how to show the multiple images.
Thank you, Ashok sir. Hello, so I would like to say something about the audio problem at the beginning. Sorry for the loss of audio. All activities which will be found in the description. Okay, so I'm going to demonstrate something dependent on the formation of multiple images. So for that we require two plain glass mirror and a printer protector, spoke in between. Okay, so the assembly can be seen in the image itself. We have to fix this mirrors in such a way that they can be freely rotate about this spoke, so that we can vary any time angle between this two mirrors. Okay, so yeah. At the first, what I'm doing is, like, I'm keeping this angle as 120. And you can see the number of images formed by the bird. So the total number of images here can be seen as 2. Now, I'm going to reduce the angle to 90 degrees. So when I'm saying 90 degrees, it is like 45 degrees from here, 45 degrees from here. So it's a symmetrically distributed about this point where I have kept my bird. Now the number of images you can see is 3, right? I'm sure you can see 3 images. So what exactly we are looking at it is, if I'm reducing the angle between this two mirror, the number of images are increasing. Now to say something in terms of mathematical formula, can I have a chalk, please?
Yes.
I'm telling you something about the mathematical formula, and this read is, the number of images formed in the mirror is equal to 360 divided by angle between the mirror is equal to 360 divided by angle between the mirrors. Formula tells me, or it can predict how many number of images you can see by varying the angle. Now I have to see the 5 images for this particular bird. What I supposed to do? I have to make this factor 360 divided by theta as 6. So 6 minus 1 will give me the 5 images. So I have to make this 6, I have to divide it by 60 degree. Okay? So 6 minus 1 is equal to 5. Now let's see whether it works or not. So I'm keeping at this 30 degree from this bird. Now let's see whether it works or not. So I'm keeping at this 30 degree from this bird, 30 degree over here. So 30, 30 becomes 60. How many images you can see in the mirror? Is it 5? Is it okay? So the number of images you can see in the mirror are 5. We saw that as the angle is keep on varying, your number of images are varying too. So the question is, what will happen to this formula, or what will happen to the number of images when this angle reduces to zero? So your problem seems something like anything divided by zero, what we term as infinity in mathematical language. So to demonstrate this activity, this setup cannot work, because if I'll make this as parallel to each other, make this angle zero, I can't see anything because it contains the block side in this area. So we cannot see light passing through it, right? So to demonstrate this thing, I have another setup. Thank you, Asuk sir. So first look at the construction of it. What I have here is a machine. Okay, which is sort of perfectly reflecting. Here is a glass, tinted glass, which is partially reflecting and partially transmitting. So, and here I have kept this light to see the images. Now I'm going to turn it around. How many images you can see? More images, right? Is it looking like an infinity wall? Is it looking beautiful? Isn't it, right? Over here. So this infinity wall, you can only find where this glass is semi-reflecting or semi-transmitting. So to explain the science behind it, I'll need the setup again, please.
Thank you.
So how we can explain this by using this setup? I have two mirrors over here, one bird which is acting as an object. So for this object, this mirror is producing an image of this object, and the image over here acting as an object for this another mirror. So its image is here and its image is here. So this is the reason when I'm changing the angle, then multiple images are forming over here. Now just I would like to ask you something. If I change the position of the bird from middle to somewhere close to another any other mirror, what happens to it? So the same thing over here, as it is 60 degree, the number of images are 5, right? We already saw that. And what will happen if I change the position nearby a mirror? So how many images you can see? Nearby a mirror. So how many images you can see? Can you see me? Can you see different images? Like last time it was 5. So the number of images got changed, right? And why this is happening? Because I have shifted its position from middle to the mirror somewhere close to it. So that this time the images is not at the symmetrical angle from these two mirror, but shifted towards a glass. Okay? So I hope you understand the concept of multiple images, and I would like to hand over.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dinesh. Thank you very much. I know you all are eager, waiting for the Professor Jain Nalikar's question answer session. But before that, I would like to mention just two activities. Suppose I need a help from the Neha also for this activity. We always see the shadow of the object is a black. Now, if I switch on this light particularly, and what is this light? I'm showing you three lights basically. And if you see carefully, the red, green, and the blue. And these type of the colors and light are called as a primary color. Primary color light basically. Normally available in every screen, like our mobile, like our TV screen, like our computer, laptop, only having the three colors. And that is a RGB, red, green, blue. But if I shine, suppose, all these colors on the screen, can you see here?
Yes.
You see the white? White is the basically addition of the all three colors. But if I place some object,
yes.
You see the white? White is the basically addition of the all three colors. But if I place some object over here, now I'm putting some object over here, and what is that object? It's my hand. Oh, it's look beautiful. I'm showing you now the colorful shadows. These are the colorful shadows. So how the colorful shadows are formed? Let me request, Neha, just hold this object. If you change this object, now hold the object over here in the pit. Yes. And if I rotate this one, you see the colorful. You see the colorful object. But see the, if I suppose block two colors now, you can see, even if I use the colorful light, shadow is black. If I change this one, if I use the red one, I can see the shadow black. If I use the even the third one, shadow is black. Suppose no matter what is the color of your single source, you'll find there is a black shadow. And see the background, suppose if I just remove this one, if I remove this one, you see the single light, this shade. This single light, greenish shade. If I use this one, reddish. But if I use all the color, you see there is a colorful shadows, and these are my secondary color. RGB, red, green, blue, primary. And this one is basically cyan, magenta, and the yellow. These are my secondary color basically. I am creating here the secondary color. But if I block one light, you see original color. You see here the original green and the blue. Image also green and blue. If I suppose close this one, open, what is open now? Green and red. I see the same color shadow. If I close this middle one, again the same color shadow. But if I switch to, then color is basically black. Black is basically absent of the light on that particular place. Now take the object, other object. Suppose if you have the pen now, you see the secondary, but I can change the color. See the original, this color. If I close this one, original colors. If I close this one, original colors. But if I switch on all three, you see them. And number of shadows also increases. Basically, I'm showing you the colorful shadow by using the multiple. In the TV screen, we see the millions of the color by just changing the intensity or number of colors and number of the lights. Instead of this, so we put the LED this way. See the here, circular. Okay, this is my PCB. But if I place some card sheet between this source and the screen, then you can see this very nice Venn diagram. And here you will get idea how that cyan form, how the yellow color form, yellow that shadow form, and the basically magenta, cyan, the inner, the colors are the secondary, and exactly outer one is the primary. You can see here the primary, that outer colors, the little bit middle, the secondary colors, and at exactly center, outer one is the primary. You can see here the primary, that outer colors, the little bit middle, the secondary colors, and at exactly center. So this is the addition of the all primary color, and you can see very nice colorful basically shadow by using only three. If you miss due to problem of the audio in our activity, we have put the link in our description box. Okay. Now I know you are eager to, you are waiting for the Professor Nalikar sir's question answer session. Just let me introduce just briefly. You know the Professor Nalikar sir is very well known person, so no need to introduce to him. But apart from his scientific research, I am talking his popularized the work of the science popularization. He wrote many books. You might read the Akashashi Zadle Nate, Cosmic Adventure, Postcard at Navidnya. He wrote many books for the common public, especially for the student community. And he conducted many shows, TV shows, radio shows, many. And for this work, UNESCO awarded him as a Kalinga Award for science popularization. So I'm not taking too much time, but I would like to request our ICER faculty professor, Saurav Dubey, please start this question answer session with Professor Jain Narlikar. So, are you, please start now.
Okay. So the first question is in Marathi and then there are some questions in English.
Yes.
पहिला जो प्रश्न आहे तो मनपा शाळा 59 बोपोडीतल्या विद्यार्थ्यांनी विचारलाय, खगोलशास्त्राचा शोध कसा लागला?
तर खगोलशास्त्र म्हणजे काय हा प्रश्न येतो. तर आपण असं समजूया, आकाशातले जे तारे आणि ग्रह दिसतात त्यांच्या निरीक्षणातून खगोल विज्ञानाला सुरुवात झाली. आता हे केव्हापासून मानव बघत आलाय सांगणं अवघड आहे, परंतु आणखीन पुढं गेलं की आपण म्हणू शकतो की आकाशातले तारका तारे ग्रह वगैरे त्यांची माहिती मिळवायला आपल्याला आधुनिक विज्ञान लागतं. तर त्याचा उपयोग केव्हापासून व्हायला लागला असं म्हटलं तर आपण असं म्हणू शकतो साधारण 150 वर्ष झाली तेव्हापासून विज्ञानाचा फायदा खगोलशास्त्राला मिळाला असं हे थोडक्यात सांगता येईल.
म्हणजे साधारण गॅलिलिओनी टेलिस्कोपचा शोध लावला हा ही सुरुवात म्हणता येईल का?
कथा असा आहे की टेलिस्कोप गॅलिलिओने वापरायला सुरुवात केली, तर त्या वेळेपासून एकंदर निरीक्षण करायची आपली शक्ती सुधारली. परंतु असं म्हणता येणार नाही की त्याच्या पूर्वी काहीच नव्हतं. उदाहरणार्थ आपण असं म्हणूया की न्यूटन गुरुत्वाकर्षणाचा नियम शोधला आणि तो ग्रहांना वगैरे वापरला, त्याआधी ग्रहांच्या ज्या नोंदी होत्या टायको ब्राहे केपलर वगैरे त्या टेलिस्कोप पूर्वीच्या होत्या, त्यामुळे तेव्हाही विज्ञान होतं परंतु जरा लो की मध्ये होतं.
ओके थँक्यू. द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन इज फ्रॉम रचना पंखवाला, क्लास 10 स्टूडेंट ऑफ सेंट हेलेना स्कूल इन पुणे. शी आस्क्स, हाउ डू यू मेजर द डिस्टन्स टू अ स्टार इन आर ओन गैलेक्सी दैट इज बियॉन्ड द रेंज ऑफ द पैरेलैक्स मेथड?
दैट इज अ वेरी ट्रिकी क्वेश्चन एंड आई एम ग्लैड दैट सम स्टूडेंट थॉट ऑफ इट. सो first of all, as she has said, that beyond the range of parallax method. Now, parallax method was the earliest method used for measuring distances. That means you look at the star from two different vantage points. So today and 6 months later, if we look, we see slight change in the direction. Because we have moved. And when we use that for calculation, we can estimate the distance of the star. That is what she started by saying, beyond that.
Right.
This parallax method does not work for very far away stars. So how do you deal with them? So the method is not as good as parallax when you go to very far away star. So the next step is to look at the luminosity of stars, that is how bright they are. So if you have two stars and one star is looking much brighter than the other, the answer as to what these stars are like, the answer could be two different ways. One could say that one star is more powerful than the other, therefore that powerful star is shining better. But if you said that no, that is not the case, the stars are of the same brightness but the fainter one is further away, so you have a different criterion for measuring distance. So there are techniques which I can't go into just now, but which make use of the fact that the stars which are fainter looking are likely to be further out. And to analyze them, we need more spectroscopic and other information, which is available now.
So that's a good point. We can ask the students to maybe read up on spectroscopy and Doppler effect, and that may put them on the right track. The next question is very interesting. It's asked by Tayyab Inamdar, class 10 student of Innovative International School. He asks, why are planets round and not square or triangular in shape?
Yes, you see, the point is all celestial bodies are bound together by force of gravity. So gravity force is such that it does not recognize different directions. It's symmetric with respect to all directions. And therefore, whenever something is being considered as formed by force of gravity, then that force of gravity will lead you. You may start by forming a star which is looking very spiky or various shapes and so on, but the gravity will readjust so that it will pull something in, something out, and until it becomes spherical. The only difference or only thing that seems to have been missed out in the question was that if these objects are spinning about an axis, then the circular or spherical shape is slightly modified. It becomes flattened at the poles, like the Earth, for example. Right. So this is all one can say in terms of forces.
Okay, thank you. Then Samavarta Satpathi from class 9th of Akshar International School in Pune asks, what generates the bright light coming from the center of the galaxy? Why is it so much brighter than other parts of the galaxy?
Usually, the interpretation about light coming from the galaxy is that it is made of, galaxies are made of stars. So the stars emit light and you see the starlight, and it is distributed across a galaxy. So this is the normal thing. Now what happens, and this is happening more and more nowadays, that there are people are finding galaxies whose center contains something like a black hole. That means a very powerful force of attraction. So when this source of attraction acts, it pulls stars in the neighborhood to closer to it. So these stars which fall near the center, they are therefore highly concentrated because the black hole is attracting a lot of them in a small volume. And therefore, light gets more bright because there are a lot of stars collected together. So it is like saying that there is a fair going on and there are a lot of kids, but the kids gather together where there is some source of attraction. Mm-hmm. So in this case, you say that the center of star is most likely having black holes, which attracts.
Okay. So the next question comes from Jeevani, who's a class 10 student of Race Concept School from Karnataka. She asks, why is Pluto not considered a planet?
Mm-hmm. Well, the history for this is like this, that over the last 10-20 years, astronomers have been discovering more and more stars which have their own planetary systems. So you have a situation where in the earlier days, only the Sun was known to be a star with planetary systems. Mm. Now we see as many as you can look for, you will see. So it is not kind of a rare phenomenon nowadays. So when this began to happen, the astronomers said we should make sure that when we talk of planets going around the star, we know exactly what we mean by planet. So they laid down, a committee met, and the committee laid down the rules for which the planets will follow. If they follow the rules, then you are part of the system. That was the rule that they wanted to make. So when they did that, they said, let us apply them first to our own planetary system. So then it turned out that only one planet of our sun's planetary system, one planet is not quite satisfying the rules. So they called that planet, which was Pluto, as a dwarf planet because it is too small. Right. Now, there is one criterion which one can apply, which is like this, that if you have a, take for example the Earth. Earth is a planet. Now, Earth has Moon as its satellite. Right? Now, there are other solar system planets which have their own satellites. Mm. So now if you take the case of the Earth and the Moon, so they are going around each other. Now the Moon, because it is fairly big, tries to control the effect, control the Earth itself, as the, of which it is a satellite. But the Earth is powerful enough to suppress any such it's like going against the rules. So the Moon is made to go around the Earth. Of course, the Earth is also going around in a certain sense. But the center of gravity of the Earth and the Moon is inside the Earth. Okay, now you apply the same rule to planet Pluto. Pluto has a satellite. And they both go around each other. And that satellite also tries to control the motion of Pluto to some extent. So now how it does so will depend on their common center of gravity. Just as we said for the planet Earth. So you have these things going, but the center of gravity does not lie inside Pluto, but it lies outside. Therefore, Pluto is not all that powerful in controlling its planet, but it makes its satellite. It tries to control, but the satellite is massive enough. So when this happens, it means that Pluto does not seem to have the full power to qualify for the membership of this club. And therefore, it has been given this subsidiary status. Dwarf planet is the name given.
सो द नेक्स्ट क्वेश्चन हा पण प्रश्न मनपा शाळा 59 बोपोडीतनं आलाय. सूर्यमाला का तयार झाली?
सूर्यमाला अमुक ठिकाणी कशी का तयार झाली, तर त्याचं कारण आता अलीकडे जे समजायला लागले ते असं की ताऱ्यांचे अनेक प्रकार असतात आणि त्यातले जे जास्त वस्तुमानाचे तारे असतात ते लवकर इव्हॉल्व होतात, म्हणजे त्यांच्यात फरक पडत आणि शेवटी ते एक्सप्लोड होतात. एक्सप्लोड झाले की त्यातून बरीचशी गॅसेस वेगवेगळ्या प्रकारचे निघतात आणि प्रेशर, हाय प्रेशर तिथं तयार होतं. त्याचं प्रेयर तयार प्रेशर तयार झालं की त्याचा अर्थ तिथं काहीतरी नवीन बन तयार होणार आहे, म्हणजे गुरुत्वाकर्षणामुळे ते एकत्र येत आहेत. तर एक्सप्लोजन हे काय झालं तर सुपरनोवा तारा, आणि तसेच सुपरनोव्याजवळ नवीन सोलर सिस्टम निर्माण व्हायची शक्यता असते असं लोकांनी पाहिले. आणि तशी तसा एक सुपरनोवा पूर्वी एक्सप्लोर झाला असणार, त्यातून आपली प्रेशर वेव्स वगैरे जे आले त्या प्रेशर वेव्सनी आपली एकंदर सुरुवात झाली गुरुत्वाकर्षणाचा फायदा घेऊन. आणि त्यामुळं का तयार झाली म्हणून विचारलं तर त्याचं कारण तिथे एखादा सुपरनोवा एक्सप्लोर झाला. आकाशगंगेत असे सुपरनोवा एक्सप्लोर होत असतात क्वचित प्रसंगी. त्याचा संबंध आता याच्याशी जोडला जातो.
The next two questions are both related, so maybe we can take them together. Shweta Bhayekar and Udita Sutradhar from Agartala both ask similar questions. What would happen if the Earth stops revolving around the Sun? And is it possible that the Earth could leave its orbit?
Well, the situation is like this. Imagine this is the Sun and the Earth is going around in a circle about the Sun. Now, why is it going around like this? So the answer is the Sun is attracting satellite, I mean the Earth. And in the Earth, as it goes around, what happens to it is the following, that it is being held in that orbit because of two forces. Sun is pulling it towards itself, and the second is it's going around in a circle, so there is centrifugal force. So these two forces balance each other, and the Earth goes around. Now, if the Earth decides to have some bad advice and tells that bad advice, why are you under the Sun? You deserve to be on your own. So become a free object. And that is what he or she is imagining, that this is happening. So if the Earth says that I don't want to go around, so it stops going around, then what happens is there is still the force of the Sun. The Sun will pull it towards it, and it will fall into the Sun and get burnt out. So it will too late, it will realize it was given bad advice. So that is the thing, that why what happens if it stops revolving around the Sun. And is it possible that Earth could leave its orbit? That is, the answer is, again, to leave the orbit, you need force to counter the Earth's attraction. So if you can produce a force like that, then it can leave the orbit. For example, you can imagine another star coming in. So this is the Sun and the star is coming, and that star sees that there are these planets, and also it sees that there are some planets which are not being given important position in solar system, so they want to quit, as all the politicians do. They are not being respected in there. So would the Earth leave the orbit? Is it possible? So that star which is coming will pull, if it has enough kind of strength, it will pull the thing. Well, the Earth, and the Earth may then go around the other star, and that star keeps going away. So this is how the politicians in stars, and they behave. They would behave according to the law of gravitation.
Okay. So the next question is from Janvi Rothe, a class 9 student of Sardar Dastur High School in Pune. It's a macabre question. Would a dead body decay in space?
Well, so far that situation hasn't come. But I would say that since in space outside, density is so low, you don't expect anything special over there. So if a body goes, that body will keep revolving. But there is nothing kind of process going on.
Bacteria.
Which will cause decay. So I don't think at the moment we have in that state.
Okay. So then we come to a set of questions that are interesting and advanced. Harsh Jagtap from Prodigy Public School in Pune and Purva Habib from DEA School ask, what is dark matter and how can we detect dark matter?
Yeah. Over the last 20, 30 years, astronomers have been detecting amounts of matter which are not visible in the same way as stars and galaxies are visible. But how do we know it's there? It's because it exerts gravitational force on whatever comes near it. So that has been the main source of observing dark matter. When you could say, what do you mean by dark matter if you can see it? So we can't see it, but we know it exists because of its gravitational attraction. So the earlier results were mainly about our own galaxy and nearby galaxy. So what happened, people were looking at how matter is moving inside our galaxy. And they found that the way they were moving showed that this center of the gravity is, of course, in the middle. If you go further and further away, the effect of gravity should decline. But as you go very far, they found that this doesn't decline, but it remains flat. So even if they are further out, the attraction is there. So this seemed to go against law of gravitation. So what they said was the following, that law of gravitation is okay, but why this is flattening is because there is other matter present which keeps attracting, and that is therefore the reason for having dark matter. But dark matter is attracting. The other, on a larger scale, you had clusters of galaxies which keep moving around each other. And theory tells us that the kinetic energy, that is energy of motion, and potential energy, which is gravitational attraction, the force of that, they should balance out in a cluster. Now, such a balance is expected, but when people began to see how many galaxies are producing, how much attraction, how much, they found that there was not enough number of galaxies in a cluster to produce that kind of attraction. So if it was not there, what is there? Or again, is law of gravitation wrong? That is why we are getting this contradiction. The answer is the law of gravitation is okay, but there is dark matter which is producing extra force and providing more kinetic energy, which you can't see visibly in terms of galaxies moving around. So that is how dark matter is being seen. People still don't know how it was created and what its nature is like. I know it is dark, but I don't know what it is made of.
Okay. The next question is from Aditya Patil and Prathamesh Kadam from Millennium National School. They ask, what is time and does gravity affect time?
Well, I think the first question, what is time? Nobody knows the answer. So I can say it is a measure of how things are happening, at what rate, and you can say something in a kind of hand-waving way without giving any mathematically satisfactory or physically satisfactory reason. So we don't know what time is. I remember in 1963, when I was just a student getting PhD, I was invited to take part in a conference in Cornell University, which was attended by about 20 people. They were all very bright scientists, some Nobel laureates and so on. So I was very honored that I was invited as part of that gathering. Now, those people, and I shared my own, what you call, ignorance with them, they dealt with that same time, same question, what is time? And they did not agree on any unique answer. And they said, we should keep meeting once in a while to find the answer. Well, I said 1963, and now we are in 2020. But no answer has yet been given. And people have to think about it. And then the second question, part of this question was,
does gravity affect time?
Gravity effect. Yeah, that one can give a better proof. There is example of stars, white dwarf stars, which are highly compressed. So they have very strong gravity near their surface. So if you look at the spectrum of those stars, the wavelength of light that is coming out, that wavelength appears to be different from what is you see normally around us. So this is happening because the stars, white dwarf stars, have got very strong gravitational field. So it tells us very clearly that gravity does affect time. It makes it go slow. That is, the clock will go slow compared to the real thing. I should tell you perhaps here a story from our mythology. You see, there was a king, his name was Kukudmi, and he had a daughter who was very beautiful, and he wanted somebody really equal to her in to marry her. He was receiving a lot of kind of requests to marry the daughter. Revati was the name of the daughter. So he said, I can't answer who is good, who is bad. Let me take them to Brahma. So he took that girl to Brahma. When they reached there, Brahma, and wanted to meet Brahma, Brahma sent word, wait a minute, I am coming, but I am completing some work here. So he waited, and Brahma came out and said, what is your problem? So he explained. So Brahma laughed. And he said, look, while you spent here a few minutes, so many thousand years have elapsed on the earth. So all those people whom you were looking for, who is the good one, they're all gone and dead and gone. But since you have come here, when you go back, again, different people will be there. So you marry Balram, who was Krishna's brother.
I see.
He's equal to you and good. So he went. He did married Balram. Now, this is an example where the clock was going slow near the Brahma.
Right.
So we had some sort of
imagination
to think of this.
So the next question then is, the next two questions actually are along similar themes. Aditya Rajhans from SNBP International School asks, is time travel possible and how could it be achieved?
Well, time travel means you can go into the past or into the future. The answer to that question is that you scientists so far know a method of going into future, but not a method of going into the past. And going into the future means you go very fast in a spaceship, and when you come back, you will find that you may not have aged much, but the rest of the world has gone ahead. So it may happen that rest of the world is 20 years ahead of you. So in that way, you have reached a future by going very fast. But you can't do that to the past. And that is logically also necessary, because the people give this example that supposing you go back into the past and you find the gentleman who was your grandfather. And not suggesting you do it, but you killed your grandfather. What will happen is, when you come out to the come back to the present, you discover that there was grandfather who died very early. Somebody killed him. But then the question was, how are you in existence if your grandfather is no longer, when your father can't be born?
Right.
You can't be born. So there is a contradiction in the whole argument, which is why going into the past is not possible. You can go into future, no such a contradiction will come.
The next question is from Chinmay Rasar, class 10th of New English School, Raman Bagh. He asks, why does gravity bend light?
Well, this was a question which Newton had asked when he was making his law of gravitation. And he had called it universal gravitation, law of universal. That means any two pieces of matter will attract each other by gravity. So that was his argument. Then he was asked, and he himself asked a question to himself, what about light? Is light part of this effect of gravity? If it is, so imagine light is going like this, and you have got a strong body here attracting others. So this light will bend down in the direction of that attractor. So the question Newton asked was, will it go on straight without bending, or will it bend near a massive object? And he was a very honest person, Newton. If he knew the answer, he will give it. If he did not know, he will say, I'm sorry, I don't know the answer. Because some scientists feel they must always have an answer to everything. It may be answer is there, but it may not be ready yet to know the answer. So this happened, and only by the time Einstein came on the scene, the same question was asked by Einstein, and Einstein's theory of gravity very clearly showed that light gets bent by gravity. So it is this what Newton could not confirm, Einstein managed to do.
Shardul Darekar, also from SNBP International School, asks, does space have a boundary or a beginning?
Well, again, we don't know the answer. And I am not, I can't say I know the answer, but I can't tell you. It's not like that. I don't know the answer. And nobody knows yet how space-time exists. In the past, and how it will behave in the future.
Okay, so we have a last question, and this is a nice sort of interesting question to end on. Yashvin Nafis from Shepherd's Path International School, New Delhi asks, what is a parallel universe?
Again, this is something which people talk about, but I am personally not in favor of the idea. The idea says that there are several universes. You are living in one universe. There is another universe in which somebody else is living. This is, now you can make such a statement and say there are universes where the people exist. And then when you are asked, what is the proof of your statement? Can I talk to somebody in the other universe? Then he will come and tell you that, no, these other universes are isolated. They are not telling you any connection. So then you are being asked to believe in something which scientifically you cannot prove.
Right.
So I feel that the idea of parallel universe may be interesting for some reason or other, but it may not be realistic.
So thank you very much, Professor Narlikar, for your time. There are a lot of questions that students ask us, and it's really fun to that we got a chance to hear you answer some of them. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for Narlikar sir and Professor Saurabh Dubey for such a wonderful session. Let me say you something about the 4-3 initial experiment. Sorry for that, for technical some reason, we lost the audio for first three activities. But quickly, I will repeat all these three activities within a few minutes. But before that, I would like to mention you, in the description box, there is a form link. So you can send your questions related to physics, chemistry, biology, mathematics. Next session we are planning on mathematics, and even after that there is a chemistry. So I would like to request you, please send us your questions in the description box. There is a link, you have to fill that form, and please subscribe our channel so that in the future you will get the notification automatically. Now let's come again this point. So initially what I showed now, the reflection and the refraction experiment. So basically what is, see this setup, there is a glass, and you see the glass is a transparent material, and you can also reflect some of the light from the glass surface. So what I am doing here now, let me lit the candle here. Okay, I am lighting the candle now, and you can see there is a, why I am looking the candle through this glass, because due to the refraction of the light, and you from that side you can see the candle exactly burning in the empty glass, but that is an image, refraction of the light, and you from that side you can see the candle exactly burning in the empty glass, but that is an image. So if I pour the water in the empty glass, image of the candle what you are looking through the glass due to the partial reflection. So this is a very wonderful experiment you can do with help of the candle, glass, or suppose you don't have this type of the glass, you can use any transparent acid. So this is the first experiment where we lost our sound. Now the next one, quickly I would like, please Aniha, take this thing. The next experiment I showed with help of the this bowl. If you see here, you can do this experiment in your home. What is the setup? Just take the bowl, and I am using here cap, but you don't need to use the cap. For the camera purpose, I am using the cap, and I am putting the coin on the cap. And if you say, just take the bowl, and I am using here cap, but you don't need to use the cap. For the camera purpose, I am using the cap, and I am putting the coin on the cap. And if you say here now, you me, I am not changing the position of the coin or bowl. What I am doing now, I am just adding water in it. Just I am adding the water now. What I am doing without disturbing any, I am not changing the position of the coin or bowl. what I am doing now, I am just adding water in it. Just I am adding the water now. And if I basically, without changing any position of the either coin or the bowl, just I added the water. And what is the role of the water? Basically, refraction. When light goes from water to a rarer medium, basically from water to air. If you see the diagram, this I am quickly explaining the diagram over here. See the setup over here. Please see the setup. So this is the position of the coin, my original water medium, basically from water to air. If you see the diagram, this I am quickly explaining the diagram over here. See the setup over here. Please see the setup. So this is the position of the coin, my originally. And without any water, suppose if I add water over here, light goes from water to here, suppose to the boundary, and then it bends, deviate. And the bending of light reach over here. And if you extend this ray backward, the coin appears something over here. So basically, this is a kind of the illusion for us. Due to refract, swimming tank appears little bit shallow than the their real depth due to the refraction of the light. But you can do this experiment in home, just ordinary material. Now, one more activity what I showed. Basically, you see there is a glass slab. Here is a glass slab and just our glass. So basically, I am putting here slab in the glass. And suppose you don't have the glass slab like this, what you can do, you can use any glass material, whatever you have in your house, but take the transparent, don't use the colorful one. So sometimes they also add some pigment of the color in the glass, but you try to use the transparent material. And here I am using the oil. What is this oil? Edible oil. Any groundnut, whatever oil in your house, na, use that oil. Now, you can clearly see that there are two material, glass, and inside there is a slab. So if I add oil over there, look here, I am adding now oil, two material, glass, and inside there is a slab. So if I add oil over there, look here, I am adding now oil. Now see that there is a, you can see some part of the glass, see the glass slab. But if I add more oil, you can see now the oil and the refractive index of the glass, what is inside slab, inside the refractive index is same. Here inside I can't change, I can't bend the path of the light, I can't bend because due to the same refraction. Okay, refractive index. And what is the basic refraction? When light goes from rarer to denser medium, it bends. That bending of light is called as a refraction, or how much light bends, that is called as a refractive index. And in this case, refractive index of the glass slab and the oil are the same, and that's why it is invisible for me. But if I see this way, sometimes they use a small pigment of the color in the making the glass slab. You can see now here, there is a slab over here. You can see the slab, but here due to the thickness only, and here you can't see. So this is the basically, I'm hiding the glass inside the oil glass. So again, let me say you thank you very much for joining this session, and sorry for initial disturbance of the audio. Please subscribe our channel for the next notification, and we all, of course, giving us a wonderful response. Please, next week, the same time, we are conducting more sessions, basically, not just one, but next Sunday, we will coming here again for the new set of the experiment and new set of the question answer session. So, but before that, I would like to remind you again, please send us, next session is basically mathematics, on the mathematics. Please send us some question on mathematics, chemistry, biology, and of course on the physics also. So thank you for joining this session, for such a wonderful session. Thank you. Bye.